Good morning, children. A warm welcome to another class of botany. Seeking God's blessing, let's start a new class. In today's class, we are going to study about other prokaryotic organism. In the previous class, we studied about bacteria. It's a prokaryote. We studied about its shape, structure. Okay. Next, how the reproduction takes place. Yes. Next, how they are useful and how they are harmful, we studied in the previous topic. In today's topic, we are going to study about other prokaryotic organism. And then, first one you are going to study is Archaebacteria. The word Archaea means ancient, primitive. Okay. So here, these bacteria, they are said to be the primitive organism. Okay, and they are prokaryotes. Prokaryotes, as we know, they do not have a well-developed nucleus or membrane. Nucleus is not bounded by the nuclear membrane. And they are adapted to thrive in extreme environmental conditions. That is, they can survive in extreme environmental conditions like hot springs, high salinity, low pH, and so on. So here we can say Archaebacteria, they are the prokaryotes which can live in extreme environmental condition like hot springs, low salinity, high salinity, low pH, etc. Next feature is they are chemoautotrophs. Chemoautotrophs means they can prepare their own food. Autotrophs means organisms which can prepare their own food. But for the preparation of the food, they require the energy, and that energy it gets from the chemical. Okay, that is, they use the chemical energy, that is oxidation of organic or inorganic substances. The unique feature of this group is the presence of lipids like glycerol and isopropyl ethers in their cell membrane. Another unique feature of this group of organism is the cell membrane. It is made up of glycerol or isopropyl ethers. As we have studied in the case of the bacteria, the cell wall is made up of peptidoglycans, that is carbohydrates and proteins are there. But here the cell membrane is made up of glycerol and isopropyl. As a result, the cell membrane does show resistance against cell wall antibiotic and lytic agents. So here, because of this composition of the cell membrane, composition is glycerol and isopropyl, the cell shows a resistance against the antibiotic as well as the lytic agents. Lytic, we have studied, it is the which can destroy or breaking. Okay, so those breaking agents or destroying agents, it shows resistance. Example for this Archaebacteria, they are Methanobacterium, Halobacterium and Thermoplasma. So this is one type of primitive bacteria we have studied. Next, we are going to study about the Cyanobacteria. Cyanobacteria is also called as blue-green algae. Okay. Now, how old are Cyanobacteria? This we can study by the fossil evidences of stromatolites. So, stromatolites reveal the truth. How old is this Cyanobacteria? So, what is this stromatolites? First, we will study that. Stromatolites are deposits formed when colonies of Cyanobacteria bind with calcium carbonate. So, this Cyanobacteria, they join together and they form colonies, and they are mixed with the calcium carbonate. Okay, and these deposits, they are formed, they are called as stromatolites. Okay, so they have a geological age. So stromatolites geological age, when it is considered, is found to be 2.7 million years old. They have a geological age of 2.7 million years. Their abundance in the fossil record indicates that Cyanobacteria helped in raising the level of free oxygen in the atmosphere. So here, the increase, as we know, Cyanobacteria, they are photosynthetic. Okay, so byproduct of photosynthesis is oxygen. So during photosynthesis, oxygen is given out. Since the Cyanobacteria is present, these bacteria, they helped in raising the oxygen level in the atmosphere. So Cyanobacteria helps in raising the level of oxygen in the atmosphere. So what is cyanobacteria? We will be studying now. Cyanobacteria, they are also called as blue-green algae or cyanophyci. They are photosynthetic. They can prepare their own food by the process of photosynthesis using sunlight energy. And they are prokaryotic organism. Again, they do not have a well-developed nucleus. According to evolutionary records, cyanobacteria are primitive forms. So they are also the earlier forms of bacteria. And they are found in different habitats. They are also found in different habitats like freshwater, and some of them they are marine, like Trichodesmium and Dermacarpa. Trichodesmium erythraeum, a cyanobacterium, imparts red color to Red Sea. So here the Red Sea, the color of the sea is red, and that is because of the Trichodesmium erythraeum, okay, a cyanobacteria. Species of Nostoc, Anabina, they live a endophytic life in coralloid root of cycas. Now endophytic, endo means inside, phytic means plant, okay. So this Nostoc and Anabina, they live inside the root of the cycas, and these roots, they are called as coralloid roots, okay. So some species of cyanobacteria like Nostoc and Anabina, they grow inside the roots of plants, okay, that is they are endophytic, and such type of roots they are called as coralloid roots. So which plant they grow? They grow in the cycas. Cycas is a gymnosperm. So here we will be studying this in the next lesson. Okay, next, leaves of aquatic fern, Azolla. So here Azolla is an aquatic fern. So here they form a symbiotic association and fix atmospheric nitrogen. So here this Azolla, okay, they grow in symbiotic association. Last class also we studied what is symbiotic. Two organisms living together and both the organisms are benefited. So here the Azolla, they are grow in the soil. Okay, they are found in the aquatic fern. By establishing a symbiotic association, they fix the atmospheric nitrogen. So here mostly you can see in the rice fields, this Azolla, they help in fixing the atmospheric nitrogen in the soil. Members like Gliocapsa, Nostoc, Cytonema are found as phycobionts in lichen thalli. So what is lichen? First we'll understand. Lichen is a symbiotic association between an algae and a fungi. So this algae partner of this lichen is called as phycobionts. Okay, so here this phycobionts, here in the lichens, what are the cyanobacteria which acts as phycobionts here? Gliocapsa, Nostoc, Cytonema. Is it clear, children? So lichen, I told you, lichen is a symbiotic association between algae and fungi. So both algae and fungi live together. Algae has an ability to photosynthesize. Fungi has an ability to absorb the moisture and provide to algae for food preparation. So here what will happen? Algae will prepare the food. That food will be shared by the fungi also. In turn, fungi will provide what? Water to algae to withstand even in dry condition. So this type of association is called, this again here it is a symbiotic association, and this is called as a lichen. So here the algae partner is called as phycobiont and the fungal partner is called as mycobiont. So here the cyanobacteria which is becoming the phycobiont, they are Gliocapsa, Nostoc and Cytonema. Now what are the salient features of the cyanobacteria we are going to study here? The members of this group, they are prokaryotes and they lack motile reproductive structures. So again, cyanobacteria, they are prokaryotes and they do not have the motile reproductive structures. That is, the reproductive structures, they do not have any flagella. Next, the thallus is unicellular. Thallus, already I told, it's a plant body. It may be unicellular or colonial. That is, they live in groups, or it may be filamentous. Okay. filament like thread like structures. So here thallus is unicellular example is Crococcus. Colonial example is Gliocapsa, and filamentous structure you can see in Nostoc. So here you can see in the diagram here. So here you can see the Crococcus diagram. Okay, next Gliocapsa, that is they are living in colonies, and Nostoc a filamentous structure here. So these are the structures in which you can find the cyanobacteria. So the plant body of the cyanobacteria. Next, gliding movement. So movements seen here, it is gliding movement is seen in some species like Oscillatoria. Gliding movement is, you can say it is the sliding movement, slipping movement. The protoplasm is differentiated into central region called the centroplasm and the peripheral region bearing chromatophore called the chromoplasm. So here we know what is a protoplasm. The content inside the cell membrane, the cellular content enclosed by the cell membrane is called the protoplasm, which includes the nucleus and cell organelles, cytoplasm. So here in the case of prokaryotes, we do not have the nucleus, but in the center of the cell, we have the genetic material, DNA. So here in the case of the cyanobacteria, the protoplasm region of the cell is differentiated into two regions. The center region, okay, it is colorless, and that is called as centroplasm. Where the DNA is present, that region is called as the centroplasm. And the peripheral region, the boundary near to the cell membrane, that region is called as chromoplasm, because it has chromatophore. Chroma means color. So colored pigment is present in this region, so it is called as chromoplasm. So here we have studied the protoplasm of cyanobacteria is divided into two regions. Center region is called the centroplasm, and the peripheral region is called as the chromoplasm. Now this color is because of the photosynthetic pigment. So what are the photosynthetic pigments present here? They are C-thiocyanin and C-thioerythrin, along with mixoxanthin and mixoxanthophyll. So these are the photosynthetic pigments which are found in this cyanobacteria. The reserve food material is cyanophycian starch. So as we know, the photosynthetic organisms, they can prepare their own food, and the food is stored. So this is stored in the form of cyanophycian starch. In some forms, a large colorless cell is formed in the terminal or intercalary position. They are called as heterocysts, and they are involved in nitrogen fixation. In some forms of cyanobacteria, they have large colorless cells. These colorless cells may be either in the tip region, that is called as the terminal, or it may be somewhere in the middle of the filamentous structure. Then it is this large body, they are called as heterocysts. And the function of this heterocyst is they help in nitrogen fixation. Next, cyanobacteria, they reproduce through vegetative methods and produce achainids. So here the reproduction is vegetative reproduction. So first method of vegetative reproduction is achainids. Achainids is a method, it's a type of cell division you can find only at the, it's not a cell division. Achainid types of vegetative reproduction is seen only at the time of unfavorable condition. So in during the unfavorable condition, the cell becomes thick wall. The outside the cell, a thick wall is formed. Okay, and the cell remains dormant for some time. And when the suitable condition comes or favorable condition returns, the cell will germinate. Okay, this is one method of vegetative reproduction. Another method is hormogonia. Hormogonia is what? In the filamentous structure, a thread-like structure, a part of the part of that filament will detach, will break, and they will reproduce by cell division. Another method is fission. Already we have studied bacteria, usually they multiply by the method of fission. One bacterial cell undergoes maturation and the DNA undergoes replication. After that, this DNA splits up. Each copies are separated out and next the cell wall, they undergo constriction and divides into two cells. That is fission. Next is the endospores. Endospore within the cell wall, the cell around the cell membrane, a thick wall is laid. So it is taking place inside the cell. So it is called as an acts as a endospore. It acts as a spore, and the spore is called as an endospore. So here we have studied the method of reproduction in cyanobacteria. It is either it may be through achinids, or it may be through hormogonia, or it may be through fission, or it may be through endospores. Next feature found here, it is the presence of mucilage around the thallus is characteristic feature of this group. Therefore, this group is also called as myxophysi. So another characteristic feature of this group is around the plant body there is a slippery substance. Okay, so this slippery substance is a characteristic feature of this cyanobacteria, and that is why cyanobacteria is also called as myxophysi. Next feature, sexual reproduction is absent. Microcystis aeruginosa, Anabaena, Floss, Aqua cause water blooms and release toxins and affect the aquatic organism. So here some of the cyanobacteria like Microcystis, Anabaena, they multiply rapidly on the water, that is called as water bloom, and they will release a toxic substance which is harmful for the other aquatic organisms. Next here, most of the cyanobacteria, they fix the atmospheric nitrogen and they are used as biofertilizers. As we know, fertilizers, they are the chemical compounds, okay, in a fixed ratios they are mixed up. But here this Anabaena, Nostoc, they act as biofertilizers, okay. They are of biological origin, they are the living fertilizers, okay. So here they directly, so the when we add a fertilizer to the soil, the purpose is to add the nitrogen, because nitrogen is essential for the growth of the plant. So here this Anabaena and Nostoc, they fixes the atmospheric nitrogen, okay, naturally. So most of them, so they are called as biofertilizers. Most of them, they fix atmospheric nitrogen and they are used as biofertilizers. Spirulina is rich in protein, hence it is used as single cell protein. So here spirulina, they are rich in protein, so it is used in the nutrition purpose. The thallus organization method of reproduction is given here. You can see already we have studied the structure. Below you can see the reproduction, subbinary fission. Next here you can see in the achinid formation in Anabaena. So here you can see in the filamentous, the grey colored structure, that is what we called as the achinid thick wall structure. Next is the endospore inside the plant body itself, the spore formation taking place. So this is what we have studied about the cyanobacteria. Next we are going to study about another prokaryotic organism, that is mycoplasma, or it is also called as molecules. Mycoplasma are very small and the size ranges from 0.1 to 0.5 micrometers. They are pleomorphic. Pleomorphic means they do not have a fixed shape, which keeps on changing its shape. And they are gram-negative microorganism. Already we have studied the gram staining technique we have studied. So here gram-negative microorganism, gram-negative organism, as we have studied, they will take the red color of the safranin. Okay, so they appear red in color. They were first isolated by Knockert and co-workers in the year 1898 from pleural fluid of the cattle affected with bovine pleuropneumonia. So pleura, we know, it is the outer covering of the lungs. Okay, so from the pleura fluid, this it was isolated. The pleural fluid of the cattle, this fluid was taken. Okay, so because the cattle was affected from this disease, pleuropneumonia, from that cattle's lungs and the pleural cavity, from that the fluid was taken, and from that this mycoplasma was isolated. This mycoplasma, they lack cell wall. okay, as we have already studied, they are pleomorphic. Pleomorphic, which keeps on changing the shape, and we know the reason for that, it is cell wall is absent. Okay, if the cell wall is present, it will have a particular shape, a definite shape. But here, cell wall is absent. Mycoplasma, they lack the cell wall, and they appear like fried egg in culture. So here, we can see the diagram here. This is the diagram for the mycoplasma. So here, it appears cell wall is absent, so it appears like a fried egg. So in the culture, you get a structure like that. Next, the DNA contains low guanine and cytosine content than true bacteria. So here we know the DNA is made up of four nucleotides: adenine, guanine, cytosine, thymine. So here in this mycoplasma, guanine and cytosine content is low compared to the other bacteria. They cause disease in animals and plants. Some examples of diseases in plants given here: little leaf of brinjal, witch's broom of legumes, phyllodi of cloves, sandal spike are some plant diseases caused by mycoplasma. Pleuropneumonia is caused by mycoplasma mycoides. So here, this mycoplasma, they causes the diseases in plants as well as in animals. So here you can see the structure of the mycoplasma. As we have studied, it lacks cell wall. So outermost layer is the cell membrane. Inside that, we can find the DNA strand is present there, and few ribosomes are present. Next structure we are going to study, next organism we are going to study is actinomycetes. Actinomycetes, they are also called as ray fungi. Now ray fungi, they appears like fungus, but they are not true fungi. So here, due to the mycelial like growth, so here fungus, the plant body of fungus is called as the mycelia. Mycelia is, you can compare it as a thread like structure. So here, in the case of actinomycetes, they have some thread like structure, but they are not the true fungus. They are anaerobic or facultative anaerobic microorganism. So anaerobic, we know they are those organisms which can respire even in the, and they respire in the absence of oxygen. Then it is called as anaerobes. Facultative anaerobes means what? With the presence of oxygen also, they will grow. When there is lack of oxygen, they will grow as an anaerobes. So, and they are gram-positive. Okay. So, here again, as we studied, gram-positive by the gram staining technique. So, they will obtain the dark purple color. They do not produce an aerial mycelium. Aerial mycelium means they will not, the mycelium is what we study as the thread-like structure, cotton thread-like structure. So they do not produce any aerial structures. Their DNA contains high guanine and cytosine content. In mycoplasma we studied, they have less cytosine and guanine content. Whereas here, in the case of the actinomycetes, they have high content of guanine and cytosine. Example for actinomycetes is Streptomyces. Now, Frankia is a species which lives in a symbiotic actinobacterium which produces root nodules and fixes nitrogen in non-leguminous plant. In the bacteria we studied, Rhizobium, one bacteria which lives in the root nodules of leguminous plants and fixes the atmospheric nitrogen. Now, Frankia is a species of actinobacteria which grows in the nodules, which forms the nodules in the roots of non-leguminous plants and fixes the atmospheric nitrogen. Such as, so these non-leguminous plants example are Alnus and Casuarina. They produce multicellular sporangium. Sporangium is again a reproductive structures. So inside the sporangium only the spores are present there. Actinomycetes bovis grows in oral cavities and causes lumpy jaw. So here, Actinomycetes bovis, they grow in the oral cavity in the mouth of the cattle and cause the lumpy jaw. That is, they are unable to open the mouth. Next is Streptomyces is a mycelial forming actinobacteria which lives in the soil. So here we are studying Streptomyces
The streptomyces, they are found in the soil. They are present in the soil and they come impart an earthy odor to soil after rain, which is due to the presence of geosmin, a volatile organic compound. So here you have noticed after the first shower of rain, so you feel the smell of the soil. So that smell of the soil is due to the presence of streptomyces. Okay, and these streptomyces, they have an organic compound geosmin that gives the that smell of the soil after the first shower of rain. Some important antibiotics, namely streptomycin, chloramphenicol and tetracycline, are produced from this genus. So from this actinomycetes we get certain antibiotics like streptomycin, chloramphenicol and tetracycline. So here children, with this we complete about the prokaryotic organisms. So today we studied about archaebacteria, cyanobacteria. Next we studied about mycoplasma, and next we studied about the actinomycetes or actinobacteria. Hope you have understood all the topics. We will continue with the next topic in the next class. Thank you, children.